Let's get rocking!
It's time for the Metal Groove.
We're fighters for truth, justice, and the American way.
A podcast dedicated to music.
Party on, dude!
Extreme close up!
Here's your metal host.
Well, hello, Mr. Fancy Pants.
Tombstone Josh.
I'm your huckleberry.
What's up, everybody, and welcome into a brand new episode of the Metal Groove Podcast. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. My name is Josh, and on today's program, we are talking about all the recent news and happenings and new members and all of the things surrounding Linkin Park. I'm going to share my thoughts, get a little review. I watched the concert. I got a bunch of articles I want to share with you guys, and we're just going to talk about it. That's what we're going to do on today's show, man. So stay tuned, stick around. I did a new metal episode a long time ago, so if some of the things I say sound familiar, that might be why. Just stick around, hang out, and as always, you guys are welcome to throw your thoughts and opinions. Tell me whether I'm right, whether I'm wrong, all of those things. Throw them in the comments, and as always, be a friend, tell a friend, share the show, help us grow. What's all about, man. So, but that's what we're doing on today's show. But first things first, you are locked in to the Thrill Me Podcast Network. Please make sure you hit that like and subscribe button wherever you are listening to this, whether it's YouTube, Spotify, Apple, iTunes, anywhere and everywhere. You see this, you see the Metal Groove Podcast, give us a like, give us a subscribe, man. It's greatly, greatly appreciated. But the network itself has a just mosh pit full of great content for you guys to check out, as well as the Tee Public store, man. We just got all kinds of merch. We got all kinds of things going on. Dive in, swim around, test the water, see how it feels to you, and join us, man. Hey, man, the water's fine. The water's fine. I promise. I promise. towards the end of the show, we always wrap up every episode with a song. Normally, it's a featured song of a musician of a band I'm talking to for that week. That's not what's happening this week. We're talking about a band that's already big. It's already blown up. I'm not talking to any members. Not going to play anything from Linkin Park on this week's show. But my good friend and my bandmate, JB, who is the bass player for my band, the Novatones, he has another project, another band that goes by the name of The Inhibitors. Fantastic band. Fantastic merch. I love this guy. I love his band. They're all talented, great musicians, man. So not only are we supporting a brother on the show this week, we are supporting a local Charleston band. So stick around. Give it a listen. Show them some love. Check out their Facebook, their Instagram. Listen to their music. You know, I'll tag some links below, man. Just check them out. It's going to be a good time. But really stick around for the song at the end. It's a great song. And I hope you guys love it, man. But all right, back into the topic for this week. All right, so a few weeks back, this band, Linkin Park, posted on their website a clock that was counting down to something, right? And the clock hit zero. And everyone was like, oh, crap. It's time for the announcement. And then the clock started going back up. It was kind of a weird thing. So the announcement was put on hold for just a tiny bit. Maybe they weren't quite ready, or maybe they didn't have everything, all their ducks in a row. But then the clock started back up, and then it eventually ended up leading to the news we all felt was coming about a singer being added to the band and that they were coming back. You know, rumors were swirling, man. The big one was Derek Wembley of Sum 41, which didn't make any sense to me. But a lot of people seemed on board with that, which, of course, Derek would have done a great job. But I don't know why he would go from retiring his massive band, Sum 41, to joining Linkin Park. And it didn't feel like the right fit to me. It would have been cool, obviously, but it just didn't seem like the right thing. To me, at least. But Derek Wembley had his own announcement going on at the same time. That's another thing that kind of fueled those rumors. Turns out he has a book going on. He has a whole lot of things going on with his personal life. You know, the book and solo stuff. So he had an announcement. He did his announcement. And then he said, hey, I'm not joining any other bands. And then the rumors started to swirl again. I saw rumors of Lizzie Hale, of course, because any role she steps in, she's going to crush. We talked about her with Skid Row a couple weeks ago. I also saw the funny rumors of Corey Feldman joining. There was just a multiple list of just singers that were rumored to be here. And I don't remember seeing this name that ended up joining them. But I think they might have nailed it. We're going to talk about it a little bit. So while I respect Linkin Park and their stamp on the rock music landscape, I was never a big fan. To me, the only standout member of the band was Chester. The music left a lot to be desired, in my opinion. But they were huge, man. A lot of people loved them. they had a lot of success. Like, going back to when I was watching that concert with the new singer, people love them. And that's great, man. If you have a band that you love and you support them, and, you know, I'm glad that they're back for those people. And they've had a lot of success, man. So I can't necessarily hate on them. They're just not for me. And watching that live concert kind of rehash those memories of why I don't really... I'm not putting any hate down, but I don't really like them. They're just not what I'm going to want to listen to. But anyways, when Chester unfortunately passed away, in my mind, that was just the end of the band. And technically, it was for a long time, man. But now, here they are. They are back with a new singer, and I'm going to share all kinds of articles about who that person is and what they're going to be up to. So, while Linkin Park wasn't only Chester, they know he is not replaceable, but they're doing their best to move forward, and that's admirable, man. So, let's talk about it. I listened to that whole concert featuring the new members, which I'm bummed I didn't release the episode when I first wanted to, because somebody has already stolen a joke that came to mind whenever I originally first saw a picture of these people all together, and that joke was, this band lineup looks like if the cast of the Big Bang Theory started a band. So, that's my little joke. Somebody already took it. It's a meme that's out there, but I had it first. I'm declaring that I had it first. I seen it. But you know, it's just funny that that's what multiple people were thinking, because that's what it looks like. It's just what it is. All right, so let's start here. Who is Emily? Well, we have a new Linkin Park singer. Dead Sarah's Emily Armstrong was officially confirmed as the band's new co-vocalist opposite Mike during the band's live stream event in Los Angeles. Now that the introductions have been made and we've heard The Emptiness Machine, the new single by Linkin Park, what do we actually know about this singer? Who is Emily Armstrong? Well, up until now, Armstrong was prominently known as the lead singer and guitarist for the Los Angeles-based band Dead Sarah. The 38-year-old singer issued 3 studio albums with the band, starting in 2012's self-titled debut. That album featured a song called The Weatherman, which, when I was going through here and doing my picking and my reading and all that stuff, I was like, what, Dead Sarah, why does that name sound familiar? Why? And then it's like, oh yeah, and this was the song, which Loudwire has listed as their rock song of the year. And it's a banger, man. Like, and it's good to be reminded of this band, because now I can dive back into their catalog and pretty much welcome to the big time for people that didn't know about Dead Sarah, or for people that are being reminded about this band. They are so good, and I hope this isn't the end of them. I did see something about them breaking up late last year, which could be related to this. Maybe this has been in the work for that long that they wanted to put maybe that project on hold. I hope, because that band was really, really good. The band also released the albums Pleasure to Meet You and Ain't It Tragic over the course of their run. Dead Sarah have performed a number of cover songs as well. They never covered Linkin Park, but they did cover Rage Against the Machine, Led Zeppelin, Stevie Nicks. They have a phenomenal cover of Nirvana's Heart-Shaped Box. Prior to Dead Sarah, Armstrong had sung backing vocals on Courtney Love's Nobody's Daughter solo album. And in 2002, Armstrong and her Dead Sarah mates received writing credits on Bones and Help Me for a Demi Lovato album, and even joined Lovato later on that track. So Linkin Park in 2024. Now that we have a new singer in place, what does that mean for Linkin Park's immediate and extended future? Well, the band has issued the new single, like I said earlier, The Emptiness Machine. They have a brand new album coming out that's called From Zero, which is due November 15th. It's currently available for pre-order if you're interested in that type of thing. In addition, fans can look for the new Linkin Park performing 6 shows this fall. And they're hitting all the big places, man. You know, they got California, they got New York, they're doing Germany, they're doing the O2 Center in London, they're hitting South Korea, and they're hitting Colombia. So they're going to be busy, man. So they're going to go on tour. They got the album coming out. They're going to be busy. There's also a few other new members that are now a part of the band. We're going to talk about that right now. Along with a new singer, they also have a brand new drummer. His name is Colin Britton. While many fans were focused on who would step into the position held by Chester, Thursday's live stream announcement revealed that Colin was stepping into the drums in place of longtime Linkin Park stickman Rob Burden. So who is the new man keeping the beat for Linkin Park's new era? Born Colin Cunningham, and the 37-year-old Nashville-born musician has primarily been making a name for himself behind the scenes as an in-demand producer and songwriter in recent years. However, he does have a history playing the drums. He initially made his inroads in the music industry playing drums for a band called Oh No Fiasco. Great name. Love that name. Who signed to 5-7 Music and released the EP No One's Gotta Know. According to Mike, in an interview with Billboard, the drums are Britain's primary instrument, but he's also adept to playing keyboards, guitars, bass, which has helped him in his roles as a songwriter and a producer in a variety of eras. Shinoda revealed that in chat that he had first met Britton around 2021 when both musicians participated in a session with a few other songwriters, and their friendship and mutual admiration sparked from there. Britton's resume behind the scenes started building around 2014, where he's been just a part of a lot of projects, man. He's been with Papa Roach. He's just done a lot of things, man. So what happened to Rob Burden? Britton has taken over behind the kit after Linkin Park's longtime drummer stepped aside. In an interview with Billboard, Shinoda addressed Burden's absence from the current lineup. Rob had said to us at a point, I guess it was a few years ago now, that he wanted to put some distance between himself and the band, and we understood that. It was already apparent, explained the singer, he was starting just to show up less, be in less contact, and I know the fans noticed it too. The hybrid theory re-release and paper cuts release, he didn't show up for anything. So for me, as a friend, that was sad, but at the same time, I want him to do whatever makes him happy, and obviously everybody wishes him the best. So not only do they have a new drummer, they also have a new guitar player. Linkin Park guitarist Brad Delson has confirmed that while he worked on the band's new music, he would not be taking part in their upcoming reunion tour dates. The guitarist was conspicuously missing from Thursday's global live streaming event as the band took the stage, with Mike noting that Alex Fetter was filling in for Delson. Fetter will reportedly be the band's new touring guitarist. In his statement, Delson shared his thanks for the support from everyone involved, expressed his awe with the band's new addition, Emily and Colin, and then offered his explanation as to why he wouldn't be a part of the run. He also confirmed Fetter's continued involvement beyond the recent performance. The guitarist expressed, "I've always felt deeply connected to and proud of our live performances. Over the years, I've realized I thrive most when I'm actively working with my bandmates behind the scenes in the studio, collaborating on our new music and helping build our live show. I'm so proud of everything we continue to create together. While I will not be performing on tour in this new chapter, I'm super excited to introduce Alex, my handsome deputy on the road. Alex is a world-class musician, a kind and thoughtful friend, and we are truly fortunate he'll be contributing his unique talent to our Linkin Park universe. Beyond excited to share this new chapter with the world, bringing our vision to life is the culmination of many twists and turns as we continue our unique journey together as a band. We couldn't do it without the belief in what is possible, even when things seemed impossible. Without the ability to listen, particularly when emotions run deep, and without the support and love of everyone around us, thank you, thank you, thank you." So that's what he went on to say on his Instagram. So, that's pretty much all the new members that are going to be a part of the band. They got a new singer, a new drummer, a new guitar player. I listened to the concert. All the songs sounded the same. I don't know if they're necessarily better or worse with the new musicians, but we're going to talk a little bit about this singer. I have one more article I wanted to share with you guys. And it's kind of a weird one because I don't know why they would change the name of the band anyways, but there's an article about why they didn't change the name, so we're going to dive into that right now. The reason Linkin Park didn't change their band name for their return: last week, the rockers made a massive comeback when they announced the additions of Emily Armstrong. After playing their first show in years to an intimate crowd in Los Angeles, sharing the track The Emptiness Machine, announcing an upcoming album and a handful of 2024 tour dates, the internet was flooded with reactions. As usual, the sentiments were pretty polarized. One of the most common criticisms has been the fact that Linkin Park kept their band name despite the absence of singer Chester Bennington. During an interview with Chicago's Q101, Shinoda admitted that they actually did entertain the idea of regrouping under a new moniker and even having a revolving lineup with different vocalists coming in. They were open-minded throughout the process, but as the music came to life, the questions were answered for them. As the music came into focus, we were like, this is as Linkin Park an album as we can make, so Linkin Park is what we're going to call it. If we call it something else, It just wouldn't make sense. He added that their fans hear the rest of the album to understand the band's decision to keep going under the name they've had the last several decades. The album name From Zero is supposed to serve as a reference to them starting over, but also paying homage to their beginnings when the group used to be called Zero. So there you go. That's just a couple articles I wanted to share with you guys. I don't know why they would change the name. Anyways, I mean, it just makes sense to stay Linkin Park. I mean, they're playing... They sound like Linkin Park. They're playing all Linkin Park songs. They're just... I know it's weird, and it's going to be an adjustment phase. Like whenever Alice in Chains came out with their new singer, and the guy sounded a little bit like Layne Staley, you kind of get that moment of, oh no, I can't believe they're doing this. But it's okay. You know what I mean? It's a part of life. You move on. If there's one thing I learned from the late, great Walt Disney, it's that progress happens. Things change. You can't stay in the same place forever. You need to keep moving forward. And, you know, I'm proud of them. I'm proud of them for that. Like I said, I haven't always been the biggest fan of Linkin Park, but I'm proud of them for moving forward and that they're doing this. So yeah, while it does sting to some of their fans, which they have some loyal fans, I think if you get on board with what they do in the past, then I think you'll accept and be able to move forward with them as well. So that's just my thoughts on Linkin Park, staying Linkin Park, their new members. I talked a little bit about, and all of those articles came from Loudwire, by the way. I just want to give them credit where credit's due. All right, so my thoughts. Originally, when you see a band is coming back, you automatically think, this is a cash grab. Maybe they're low on funds. Maybe they need to make some money. Maybe they have, you know, something to push. This is a cash grab. But in this case, I really don't feel like this is a cash grab. I really feel like Linkin Park loves. I feel like they adore. And I feel like they respect their fans too much to just come out and put on some sideshow and just for a cash grab. So watching them and kind of seeing their sentiments and their heartfeltness and the way they were interacting, you know, with the crowd, this doesn't feel like a cash grab. So good for them, man. Glad they're going on tour. Glad they're going to be doing an album. Am I going to go see them on tour? No. Am I going to buy the album? No. The new song, Emptiness Machine, it's not for me. Sounds like Linkin Park. That's awesome. Good for them. Proud of them. Now the singer, Emily Armstrong. Damn, this girl can sing, man. She's a phenomenal singer. She's a great front woman. I loved her stage presence. I mean, obviously, she's been doing this for a long time. I have always been on the mindset of, I just think rock and roll sounds better with a high-pitched, just kind of feminine singer. You know, you think about Axl Rose. You think about Steven Tyler, Sebastian Bach. I mean, Haley from Paramore, Lizzie Hale. I just feel like a woman. I mean, Chester. Let's give Chester where it's due. Chris Cornell. I mean, Chris Cornell could hit many, many octaves. Same with Miles Kennedy. But I just feel like rock and roll sounds better with that kind of high-pitched squeal. But if we go back to what Emily did in Dead Sarah, she had a very clean register. And all of her, like, her voice is beautiful. Like, I love her voice. I love the way that she sings just naturally. She also has a really good growl to her voice, which I could tell. I'm not going to say she was trying to copy what Chester was doing, but I feel like she was putting her own stamp and her own spin on the way Chester would sing those songs. Not to copy him, but to do it in her own way. And to see her go from clean vocals to kind of like growling scream vocals was just perfect, man. She's really good, man. She's a great singer. And I think whatever Linkin Park does moving forward with her, it's going to be great. She's no Chester. I mean, nobody really is Chester. Got to give credit where credit's due. But we're not replacing Chester here. We're just moving on to the next version, which they call it Linkin Park version 2.0, man. Like, what is it? It's the next. I don't know. It's not a copycat. It's not meant to be a copycat. It's just meant to be a new chapter. So it's not a remake or a reboot. It's just something new, man. So props to them. Good for them. Linkin Park. When I was going through watching that concert, so when I said earlier, watching it reminded me why I don't particularly like them. And watching that concert kind of reminded me of that. And the reasons I don't like them, it's not because they're not a good band. They have hits, man. They have very catchy songs. They have a lot of anthems that people can pump their fists to and sing along to. To me, it seems kind of like the same song over and over, like the kind of sound effect, the kind of backdrop, kind of lead in. And I really felt like every song that was starting is like, oh, it's that song. And then it turned out to be another song. I'm like, all these songs sound the same. And then also their energy on stage is not indicative of what I think of with a rock band. Other than Emily, she was crushing it, man. She was all over the place. Mike was kind of all over the place. I mean, maybe he's subdued a little bit. But the band kind of just standing there is what they've always been to me. It's just kind of like a mechanical sound, kind of like an engine just churning. Not doing anything in particularly spectacular, but just churning and moving along. And they had a great backdrop. The stage looked cool. The little screen that they had above them was really cool. They have a lot of great songs. They had a lot of hits, man. And I got into a little bit of a bickering argument with my brother because I was like, once I was re-reminded of the band Dead Sarah and I started listening to him again, I was like, oh my God, this band is better than Linkin Park. What, to me, this is what I would prefer to listen to. And he's like, I wouldn't go that far. So shout out and props to anybody that is a Linkin Park fan. But Dead Sarah to me is a better sounding band than Linkin Park. If I'm going to turn on music, that's what I'm going to listen to. And Dead Sarah is kind of like in the same vein. If you don't know Dead Sarah, they're kind of in the same vein of like the Pretty Reckless kind of maybe Hailstorm a little bit. They're just kind of, they're rocky, straightforward rock and roll. No need with this backdrop, fake sounding mechanical stuff. Again, no hate, just my opinion. All right, last thing I wanted to touch on for this week's episode. I said a little bit about it earlier, but The Emptiness Machine, the brand new song by Linkin Park, it's out now, streaming everywhere. You can go listen to it wherever you like to listen to songs. But it's pretty much standard Linkin Park stuff. You know, you have Mike coming in with his vocally things. Then you have Emily come in with the kind of upbeat chorus to kind of pump along. Screamy kind of anthematic chorusy parts. So it's cool, pretty standard Linkin Park stuff. Not my cup of tea, as I've said over and over this episode. They're not what I'm going to choose to listen to if I'm going to turn on something on my radio. But for those of you that are Linkin Park fans, I think you will enjoy it, man. It's a decent song. It's okay. It's what they opened their live stream event with, and I think it was a good introduction to what the band is probably going to be moving forward. So cool, man. If you guys have heard it already, please let me know your thoughts. If you go listen to it and you want to revert back to here and tell me whether I'm wrong, I welcome it. Just come on in. I'm not a big Linkin Park fan, so I would love to hear from actual Linkin Park fans what they think of the new singer, what they think of the new song, and if they're excited for this new chapter of the band moving forward. Those are my thoughts. Thank you guys so much for checking in. This is where we're going to be talking about my friend JB and his band, The Inhibitors. I've got to see them play on stage. They're an awesome band. They're full of energy. They have a unique, interesting sound. I believe, if you go on their bio, it says reptilian rock music. And JB is the lead singer of this band. And he's a great dude. They're all good dudes. I'm proud to know him. I'm proud to be in a band with JB. And I appreciate him. I was like, hey, man, I want to play your band's song on my show this week. And he was cool with it. And we're going to play it right now. It's a song called Spiders. It's on their album that is called Reptile Dysfunction. Check it out. Listen to them. Support them. Look this band up on Spotify, on Instagram. Give them some follows. Give them some support, man. And I hope you guys enjoyed this episode. Like I said earlier, please make sure that you like and subscribe. And stay tuned. We have a lot of stuff in store. I got a brand new interview lined up with an awesome metal band. I got a couple of them, actually. So I'm hoping to post more consistently. My band, the Novatones, is out there crushing it almost every weekend. We got this weekend coming up. We're off, actually. I'm headed to see Steel Panther in Augusta, Georgia. Looking forward to it. I haven't seen Steel Panther in probably about a year and a half. I freaking love that band. I'm looking forward to seeing them. But yeah, that's this week's episode. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. This is a song called Spiders by The Inhibitors. Turn this ish up. I hope you guys enjoy it. We'll see you next time. Stay metal.
What I want to do to the devil, yeah.
I just sent your address to some spiders. They're rolling dope and stealing all your liars. I just sent your socials to some spiders.
Hey, that's the show for this week. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Please make sure you hit that like and subscribe button. And join us here at the Thrill Me Podcast Network, where you can check out phenomenal shows like Haunters Podcast, The Review of Rob Show, The Mr. Wonderful Show, and Core Memory Unlocked. We greatly appreciate you. And until next time, stay metal.